Hello, everyone. Welcome to tonight's workshop, Students Asked, We Answered. This is the first part of a two-part series of student questions and expert answers. And tonight we're going to be focused on plant science when we get to that section of the night. And the next webinar that is coming up on July 27th will be focused on animal science. Before we get started, let's talk about some of the workshop norms. If you haven't been here tonight, our time together is scheduled for an hour and a half. Throughout the workshop, make sure you're muted unless we say like, hey, unmute and share, which we will throughout this, this workshop. Or if you see the microphone icon on your screen, you are welcome to use the chat for thoughts, for links, for sharing throughout the entire webinar. And Hannah, my colleague, will be monitoring the chat and will be answering questions as they come up. We'll be collaboratively working in breakout rooms a little bit later. And I just ask that you participate as you would want your students to do in a breakout room. So engaging, having your camera on and chatting, that's what's gonna make the experience really rich. And we have created a takeaway document. Hannah's gonna drop it in the chat for you. That is your one-stop shop for all of the links that we'll be using today. We're gonna reference them throughout for you to look at and for you to use and then be able to use after the workshop as you start to implement some of these NGSS strategies into your classroom or where you show up. Speaking of where you show up, I want you to join the chat and share what made you decide to come to this workshop tonight. Because we'd love to hear. I know some of you have been here before. Some of you are in like a classroom, whether that's K-12, or maybe you're in a different setting where you work at a farm or cooperative extension. Love to hear why you came so you can learn more about NGSS and how that shows up in your life. Love to see science ideas. Feel free to chat where you are. I know we have Seattle in the house. I know there's someone from Georgia in here. Chicago, that's right. Develop curriculum for California Ag in the Classroom. We have Arizona, Kentucky, another Chicago, two Kentuckys. Work at a farm and we do farm field trips. That is awesome. Homeschool teacher, lives in California, seventh grade teacher, looking for elementary science lab with a garden, instructional coaches, teaching environmental, ag teachers, agriculture background, and high school teachers. Amazing. So we have a wide variety of people, which makes this so much more fun because we all-
I'm so sorry, I'm driving, so I didn't get in on chat.
That's okay.
I live in Idaho, and I am a STEM teacher, heart of potato country. We get 2 weeks off in September for the potato harvest and all the kids go to work. So this is a perfect combination for me and junior high science.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing, Misty. So we're going to be able to share all of our experiences and share how it works for us. And hopefully we'll be able to take something away from the other people who are here in the room with us. Before we get started, I just want to introduce myself. My name is Sarah Nurswick. I spent 10 years in high school classrooms in Maryland, Georgia, and North Carolina. And currently I spend my days specializing on NGSS unit development. And I'm excited that we get to start chatting with part one. We're going to start learning, going straight into the business here about learning a practice that you can use in your classroom that is really essential to the NGSS principles is getting kids to talk. Getting kids to not just talk and chat about the soccer game or the football game, but to productively talk about the science practices that they're engaging in. And the reason we think this is important or know it's important for you guys to learn learning routines that you can duplicate in your classroom and use and have your students become really familiar with them, where your students are ending up taking the lead of what you're teaching. And that's where the magic happens, is when the kids are taking the lead. So we are going to talk about productive talk first. And before we even get started, and I have Hannah teach you about productive talk, I want you to write in the chat, what do you already know about productive talk in the science classroom or engaging in science curriculum? So what does productive talk mean to you? You can type that in the chat. If you can't type it in the chat, we will have time to unmute a little bit later. Limited, that's okay. That's why we're here, here to learn, here to grow. Making predictions, okay. Asking open-ended questions. What else comes to mind? Group discussions. Discussion between students. Inquiry-based learning, sparking curiosity. Decision-making, meaningful conversation, staying on topic. They have a purposeful discussion on one topic. Awesome. Haven't heard the term? Awesome. Well, we are going to get into it. My colleague Hannah is going to teach you about productive talk. And just so you know, Hannah, also, we're very similar. She had 10 years of experience in the high school agri-science classroom, and she manages cutting-edge NGSS projects, and she also crafts top-notch new units, which are helping teachers like leave their lesson plans really feeling fresh and inspired. So, Hannah, take it away, and let's learn about productive talk.
Like Sarah said, our goal is that you walk out today with new tools in your tool belt that you can use in the classroom when you return this fall. And hopefully that's a few weeks away, at least at this point. And I am just so excited to share a little bit more about what productive talk is and how you can facilitate it in your classroom. So let's take a moment to just review these four things that you see on the screen and think about like what productive talk can do for you in your classroom. So the first thing that it can do is deepen sense making for your students. And it really can create this authentic curiosity about scientific inquiry. And for our students, when they think about engaging in peer-to-peer conversations, this productive talk can lower the stress for students in those conversations and also improve language development in all learners, but also especially in our language learners. So let's take a second to think about and be ready to chat by unmuting. Why do you believe that productive conversations between students is important in science classrooms and especially our next generation science standard classrooms? So you can go ahead, you can either share in the chat if that's comfortable for you, or if you would like to unmute, now's the time for you to unmute and share why you believe they're important.
Hi, this is Sherry Yu. I'm just going to jump in here.
Yeah, go for it.
I have been teaching for 20 plus years, and I have seen the steady decline of our students not being able to converse with each other. And I really think that it's really super important for them to learn how to be able to present ideas and talk to each other and not just text.
Yes, ma'am. I love that. I would agree. And it looks like others in the chat are saying like, it's an opportunity for kids to share ideas and life experiences. It's a way to expand on engagement. They can learn from each other. Everyone can contribute in the conversations. These are all what productive talk strives to do. So some of the benefits or what we know that students engaging in these conversations, we know that it's beneficial to the whole student. And specifically in science, we're excited when students get into these conversations and into this productive talk space because having conversations with one another is a real life science practice. And Sherry, like you said, it's a real life just practice in general for students to be able to have. It also helps students share and clarify thinking and their understanding of science. Like it deepens their understanding of science. It helps them listen to others and learn more information. It helps the students deepen their own reasoning of why they think what they think. And it allows students to think together and engage in sense making. And I think we can all agree that the things that you see on the screen here are things that we would love to have in our classrooms, things that you would love to see in your classrooms. And you might be thinking, okay, how do I get students into productive talk and support them in this task? Like, I'm sure there are different ways to do that. How do I do that? And I get it. I want to make sure that I am prepared when trying a new teaching strategy. So let's dive into some of the processes of productive talk. So productive talk can be used for specific purposes in the classroom. And these are just four examples of different ways that you can use it in the classroom. So it could be used specifically to help students explain their thinking. It could also be used if you have students creating a model and that model needs critique and feedback. It could also be used if students need to revise their thinking or if you want students to reach some sort of consensus. So in a moment, a poll will pop up on your screen. And in your opinion, which of these four productive talk examples would you like to refine in your classroom? So give me just a second and I'm going to slide over to the polls. And it should launch here. So you should be able to see the four different options. And you can go ahead and click on which one you would like to refine, which one you would like to maybe even introduce in your classroom this fall. About half of you that have responded. Give you about 10 seconds more. Okay, so which of these four productive talk experiences would you like to refine in your classroom? So it should share out here. You should see them on your screen. It looks like 55% of you would love to have explained thinking refined in your classroom. 21% said critique and receive model feedback. 11% said revised thinking and 13% said reach consensus. So it kind of makes sense, right? We need students to be able to explain their thinking before we can get to some of those other pieces anyways. So that is super helpful just to kind of see where everyone's at and where what we're thinking. All righty here. So the good news is that we are going to be using this talk activities flowchart, which you see on your screen from STEM teaching tools to go through a few different scenarios that might happen in your classroom and pick out what certain talk practices we would use. So we'll have a scenario on the screen and you will post your guess of what talk activity you would use in that scenario using the Zoom poll. That's going to pop up just like we practiced here a second ago. You can access this graphic. Like, it might be a lot going on or maybe you can't quite see it very well, but the takeaway document, Sarah just put it into the chat. So you can access that takeaway document and this flowchart will be present on that takeaway document. So you can pull it up and it can be a bigger screen for this next process here, this next activity here. So I'm going to go ahead and read scenario one, and then I'll give you four options from this talk activities flowchart that we can potentially use as a productive talk practice. All right, so scenario one, your students have done independent work and need to come together in small groups to share the information they learned. Which of the following activities would you use for this scenario using the talk activities flowchart? Your talk activities flowchart, again, in the takeaway document, so you can reference it. Would you use, and I'll open up the poll here so you can see. Okay, here's your four options. Write and pass, four quadrants, discussion diamond, or agree, disagree line. I'm going to give you some time here to think. Look at that chart. Looks like about half of you have kind of dug in. Okay, I'm going to give you about 15 more seconds to look through that flow chart and see which one might you use with this scenario in your classroom. All right, make any last minute choices. I'm gonna close up the poll. So it looks like a good portion of you, about half, said the discussion diamond, and then the other three are somewhat varied. And I would agree with the majority of you that said discussion diamond, that the discussion diamond would be a good option for this activity. This activity allows students to write their ideas on the corners of paper, and they share the ideas and evidence and come to consensus in the middle of the paper. All right, so we're gonna try this again. Scenario two. Students have started creating a model of how plants create food through photosynthesis. And they are still working on their models, and the teacher would like them to see where the class aligns on certain topics of photosynthesis. So we're going to try this again. And the poll will open up. We have the same four options again. So there's write and pass, four quadrants, diamond discussion, or agree, disagree line. So they're creating a model. They need to kind of see where is the class like aligning on stuff? Where are students kind of off? Where do they need to kind of come to consensus? Getting some feedback on their models. Give you about 15 seconds more. It's helpful that we use the same four, so you'll become comfortable with them as we go through the next scenario. Okay, we have a majority vote again, it looks like. Okay. It looks like, again, 49% of you are, say the agree and disagree line. And I would agree with this again. So the agree and disagree line lets you as the teacher kind of drive the questioning to see if students are aligned or not aligned on their models using the agree or disagree questions. So you're doing great. I know this takes a little bit to kind of take a look at what's there and what different options you have. We're going to try this out one more time and we'll use the same four again. And so we're going to take a look at scenario three. Your students are in the middle of a unit and just learned new information that might change their original thinking about the phenomena. Okay, so changing their original thinking about the phenomena. I'm going to open up this poll again. You have the same four options for productive talk practices. You can choose write and pass, four quadrants, discussion diamond, or agree and disagree line. So if you're thinking about this, which one would you, what activity would you choose? What productive talk activity would you choose? Students are in the middle of a unit. They just learned new information that might change their original thinking about the phenomena. Oh, you guys are fast on this one. I can tell you're starting to become familiar with the four that we chose for tonight. Okay. I'll give you about 10 more seconds because you guys are speedy tonight. This crew, Sarah. They're quick learners. Okay, so I had 48% that said write and pass, and then 38% that said the four quadrants. And you're right, there's two options here for this scenario. So if you would like your students to engage using written language, the write and pass activity works best. And if you would like the students to use images, four quadrants activity will be your best bet. Okay, so this tonight was just meant to kind of get you like familiarized with some of these different activities that you can use. And I just appreciate you digging in and engaging in that activity. My suggestion, print that baby off, put it on your bulletin board next to your desk or right on your desk and use it as your lesson planning to build in some of those productive talk activities. All of these activities from the talk activities flowchart and other NGSS aligned discussion-based activities are reaching these four goals outlined by Ambitious Science Teaching. I'll talk about them in just as we go through here. So if you look back to your talk activities flowchart, the activities on the left are aimed towards this first goal, which is elicited student response or students' initial scientific hypotheses in to plan for further instruction. And this is an important first step to get students to start thinking, like to understand phenomena. And these activities aimed toward this goal also give the teacher input on how to tweak upcoming learning activities to meet the students where they are in their understanding. Now, goal number two is making sense of data and information. And as you continue through your instruction, students will be presented with data, they'll be presented with information to help them make sense of the phenomena. And talking through this new content allows students to understand it better. So it also allows you to see what learning goals the students are meeting. And the activities in the middle two columns can help you navigate the student goal of making sense of new data and information. In goal three, connecting activities with big scientific ideas, students are combining what they've learned through data and information and conversations in order to expand their understanding of the broader phenomena. And this gets them really thinking towards the bigger implications of what they are learning in the world of science and not just that one phenomena. And this can be achieved by engaging again in those middle two columns of the talk activities flowchart. And finally, in goal four, it is pressing students for evidence-based explanations. And at this point, we are wanting our students to be able to construct comprehensive explanations of their learning. And you can help students achieve this by trying out the activities in the far right-hand column of the talk activities flowchart. So now that you have a new understanding of how important productive science talk is, tell us by using the chat which of these goals you would like to improve on in the upcoming school year. So type one for number one that you see on the screen, two for two. So number one is elicit students' initial scientific hypotheses to plan for further instruction. Two is making sense of data and information. Three is connecting activities with big scientific ideas. And four is pressing students for that evidence-based explanation. Ooh, I see a lot of threes and fours, a couple of twos. So we're working on data and information, making sense of it, connecting activities with big scientific ideas. And a lot of you are wanting students to be able to use evidence to explain. Heck yes, I agree. That's kind of sometimes the hardest one to get students to do. Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that. Now, I know that there's some of you out there that are going like, I can totally see that some of you are thinking this. You're going, oh crap. The kids are arguing, this is supposed to be productive talk and it's not. What do I do now? And if we're being honest, one of the occupational hazards of having authentic conversation in your classroom is that discourse is going to be present. It's going to happen. That's just how it is. And the good thing that we all know is that discourse is not only important in science conversations, but it is a skill. Like Sherry said, this all is a skill that students need to engage in and practice to be successful in really in all areas of life. So we've shared a couple of resources with you from Wisconsin Center for Research Education that you can use to help strengthen student reasoning when discourse is present, just as a support for them. And it is in the takeaway document. So you can grab those, you can print them and give them to students or put them on your learning management site while students are having these productive talk conversations to support them when discourse happens, when they need some additional support. So I hope that you feel excited and prepared to make productive talk a common occurrence in your classroom. And I appreciate you just hanging out with me a little bit tonight. Oh, Sarah, we can't hear you.
Yay. Just giving Hannah a round of applause. Thank you for sharing. We have a second that if anybody has a question about productive talk, we can answer that. You can unmute or type it in the chat really quick and we will get that answer before we move on to the next routine. All right, we have two questions in the chat. I'm going to go with Amy's question. Is it logical, Hannah, to use these on all grade levels? And Amy, I'd love you to write in the chat what grade level you teach to as she's answering this question.
That's a great question. I am, very curious in what grade levels you teach. I think it is. And well, I've only taught high school, middle school, grade levels. I think it just depends on what support you're providing students and how you teach productive talk to them. There's some resources in the takeaway document that can help you, but the idea is that you're not just going to be like, okay, productively have some conversations. But as the good teacher that you are, you're first going to teach them like, hey, this is what productive talk is, and this is how we're going to use it. And for your middle school students, like you might need to provide them with more support, kindergarten through 11th grades. So if you think about your younger kiddos, they're going to need more support. They might need sentence starters. They might need you kind of there. Maybe it's like you do like smaller groups with them to kind of support them through that. And then as they build up to those upper grades, again, don't skip that part of teaching them what is the practice that you want them, the activity, the productive talk activity. Don't skip the directions for that, but make sure that you teach those directions and those upper level kids will get it after you practice a few times. I think the idea with it is if you can make this a consistent part of your classroom, a consistent practice in your classroom, your students will mid-year be able to just jump right into productive talk practices, no problem.
Awesome. Thank you for sharing, Hannah. One of the routines you just talked about that popped up in my brain that I know my five-year-old who's going into kindergarten would do is the agree-disagree line. He has opinions, right? He has thoughts and, you know, they experience phenomena at such a different level. So I think that like looking at those routines that you saw in that flow chart and seeing like where can they fit? But Hannah's absolutely right. It's about the support that you provide them. And here is one way to get some productive talk going in your classroom by using the five whys. We already know that talking is so important. Now it's time to explore how to have these conversations. So before we get into this, I would absolutely love if one of you could unmute and volunteer to be my participant. You know, like I'm a magician and I need a participant. Who's up for it?
Okay, I will.
Thank you, Misty. Misty, you're from Idaho. Okay, you are a middle grades teacher. Can you tell me a little bit more about what you use, like why this webinar is why are you here tonight?
Okay. So I teach junior high science, life science, seventh grade life science is newly added to my schedule this year, eighth grade earth science, but I also teach first through eighth grade STEM in a great STEM lab. But because we live in the heart of farm country, I want to really focus on the STEM part that the kids can take home with them. So, I mean, the pneumatics and the welding and kind of the trades type of projects. And so the name of this conference just hit the nail on the head. It was a must do.
Yeah. And tell me when you're providing these students the stuff they can use in their houses, like what do you think that's going to do for them in the long run?
Oh, it's huge. We've talked about soil science. We've talked about pH and all of the things that they hear, you know, mom and dad have conversations about at the dinner table, and things that, you know, some of them know more about it in connection to, they just don't know the science behind it. So they hear what the pH should be, but they might not know why. And so then it just, you know, they can contribute right off just from growing up and you know, they may be just regurgitating what they heard, but they don't realize how valuable that is and how much I appreciate it as far as sentence starters and conversation topics and whatever.
Yeah. One more question to finish us up. What do you think them knowing this knowledge? I mean, I know you work through first through eighth in your STEM lab. How do you think that could impact your community with that science knowledge being more deeply rooted in all your students?
Oh, huge. We've started just barely in the discussion process of starting a business through the STEM lab where the kids could do soil samples for the community. Just as a, you know, very basic moneymaker, it would be just very basic compared to what they actually pay for. But, you know, we have a very supportive community, and I think that they would be willing to do that and then compare the results to, you know, the official results, so to speak.
Misty, thanks for sharing. That was so exciting. Like the business, you perked up my ears and I got really excited about what your kids are going to be able to do with you in the classroom leading them. So thank you for sharing. Give Misty a round of applause virtually. Now I want you to think about the conversation you just listened to. Can you see how the answers changed as I continually asked her questions? Drop a thought in the chat. Like, what do you think the purpose of what I just demonstrated is? What is the whole purpose of why I did that? You can throw it in the chat. Yeah. So Stacy said, explaining thinking. I got to connect more. Deeper thinking, less surface level answers. Got to think about specifics. More engaging. I think you're modeling what we should do with our students. Absolutely. Great. Thank you for sharing. So what I just shared is a technique called the 5-Why strategy. And the purpose of this strategy is to explore the cause and effect relationship of underlying problems and phenomena. Now, Misty is not a problem nor a phenomena, but I was able to get really deep into like her heart and what she wants for her community and what she wants out of her students just for her showing up tonight. That was not a surface level answer. And this is not something that we dreamed up and Hannah and I came up with. This was actually created by the person who founded, the inventor and founder of Toyota, who's also aptly named Toyota. And the Wi-Fi 5-Why strategy became very prevalent in the 1970s and is still used at Toyota today to solve problems. And you just saw me demonstrate it. So it's pretty easy to implement with your students. And the purpose is for you to really drill down to the root cause of something. So if you think about a problem or phenomena, and we're going to use this as an example in a breakout room in just a little bit, we're asking the students to find the why behind this thing they're looking at, the why behind this problem we're presenting to them. In each instructional unit or each lesson that you're providing the students. And I want to like for everyone here, I know we all have differing backgrounds when it comes to NGSS, just review real quick phenomena and problem. So a phenomena is a specific context and it should be aligned to your three dimensions, especially your disciplinary core idea or your learning standard. It must be observable. Okay. I know at the last webinar, we talked about whales bubble feeding. That's observable. I can watch a video of them doing it, or I can go to Sitka, Alaska and watch it happening in real life. It should also promote curiosity. It should not be lame. Okay. This is where we get to be the cool teachers in this school, where they go to their next teacher and say, oh my gosh, I just had so much fun in Miss Wedger's classroom. This is where the curiosity comes from and why phenomena is so valuable, because it's going to help them remember it. It should be engaging and they want to learn more. Now, a problem is going to have the same characteristics of a phenomena, but it also requires a solution. So if we're thinking in the engineering side of our NGSS standards, it should have an actionable solution or proposed solutions that could address that phenomena. And it might be presented in the form of like an argument or even a prototype, which is a really cool aspect of what we're able to do with the DCIs presented in NGSS. So on the next screen, you're going to see three phenomena. Okay. These are also on your takeaway document. I'm going to go over them very quickly. When you go into your breakout rooms, your group is going to choose one of these phenomena to practice the 5-why strategy with. So you're gonna practice going back and forth and asking each other deeper questions. Option one is to discover a little bit more about why songbirds are found in pastures with cattle versus without. Option two is diving into how dairy cattle population has decreased, yet milk production has increased. Or finally, thinking about without, like, some grasslands without fire would disappear. So here is how the breakout room is going to work. In your group, you're going to choose one phenomena. And like I said, it's on your takeaway document if you didn't grab those ones I said really quickly. And I want you to have a conversation just like I did with Misty. Use the 5-why strategy. Like, Hannah, why do you think that more birds are on those fields? And she'll say something. Is it right? It might not be. The whole point is to get ideas out of the brain and on to paper. Okay. I want you to try and drill down to what's the root cause of that phenomena and why do we even care? Okay. Why do we care about that phenomena? Remember, this is what productive talk is. Productive talk means we're getting closer to an answer. We're getting closer to asking the questions that are going to get us to the end goal. When you return from the breakout room back into this main room, you're going to share one or two of the questions that stood out to you in the conversation. Maybe it was something somebody asked you. Maybe it was a question that you asked somebody that helped you dive deeper into the conversation about the phenomena you chose. So Hannah is going to throw you guys into breakout rooms of about three people, and you have 10 minutes. We'll keep a timer over here and we'll project on the Zoom chat telling you guys when you have 5 minutes left and then when you have 1 minute left. Are there any questions before you move into your breakout rooms?
Right. Your rooms are open. You'll just have to hit join, or sometimes you have to go down to the more button and hit breakout rooms, but it looks like some of you are already moving, so you can head on over to that breakout room and start engaging in some conversations. And if you need help.
If you need help or you can't end up getting into a breakout room, I want you to have a conversation with yourself. Okay. What would you say? What would that answer be? And then what would you say next? And what would that answer be? So still go through this, even if you can't, technology is not working for you. All right, welcome back. As you guys are getting situated, go into the chat and share some of the questions that your group came up with. Something that you heard, something that you said, something that got the conversation to continue to go. Go ahead and type that in the chat. Where did you end up? I'm so excited to hear how this went. Do you feel that the consumer has anything to do with the amount of milk production today? Or did they just reap the benefits of milk? Awesome question. That's really diving deep into that phenomena slash problem. Well, it's not a problem, it's a phenomena. Engaging through the questions, got to know people really well. Love that. Love to hear it. What are songbirds? Great question. Are the birds and cows partners? Are they beneficial? Great question. Anything else that popped up? We wanted to do this. Okay. Why songbirds in pasture rather than their own grassland? We chose dairy production. We asked why more milk. Talked about got to genetics and nutrition in their whys. That was not included anywhere in that phenomena that we gave you. And they got down the root of nutrition and genetics. What are the genetic factors that may lead to greater production? How has modern technology benefited dairy farmers? How has modern technology benefited milk consumers? Hannah, it's basically the life that we live all day long right now. This is so awesome. Just today, I was writing a routine for students to do this exact thing, to have questions, to generate questions, and then get into a group, share your questions, see where you all landed, and then continue to ask more questions. The whole purpose of this is to dive deeper. And although I think it was Carolina said they got to know each other in the groups and like what they did and their goals and what they want to do, that's exactly using five whys in the way that it's done. You might change it a little bit when you get in your classroom and you want your students to talk about phenomena, but you guys just practice it. And I appreciate you guys getting into those conversations and chatting. Let's get there. Can't wait for you guys to use it. It's a very simple one. You don't need any directions. Just ask your kids. Keep on asking why. Keep on going.
Yes, keep on going. So let's give Sarah a virtual round of applause. Thank you for sharing your expertise and experience with us, Sarah. And we want to make sure that if you have a question, you can answer it. So before we move on to the last part of our time together tonight, if you have a question, you can go ahead and drop it into the chat and we will let Sarah answer one of those questions. So any questions about the 5-why practice routine? And how you might use it.
If no one has a question, I just have a thought. If you're teaching this routine to your kids and you're scaffolding it, it might be easy to start with something that maybe yell at me and tell me you're the police that like the NGSS police that if it's not productive, but have them talk about their weekend. Why? So they get used to the routine. Talk about the soccer game or the football game that what is big and happening in your school. Get them to talk about that. So they understand that when you ask them to talk about it with songbirds, when you ask them to talk about it with dairy production, they know the routine. So cannot wait for you guys to use it. Thanks for listening. All right. Take it away, final part.
All right, friends, this was one of the things that we were most excited about when our team was putting together this professional development series. And we thought, like, hey, we need to ask students what the heck kind of questions they have and answer them so that you as the science teachers don't have to like figure out what are the answers to these questions that students have. So it's time to hear from those students and think about this portion of the night like Stephen Colbert's skit on The Late Show. And if you're unfamiliar with it, Sarah's going to share a quick 30-second clip.
We'll talk about it later. Hi, kids. I'm Steven. And yes, I'm very knowledgeable, but you can be too. All you need is a team of researchers paid for by the budget of a television network. And right now, my massive brain is at your disposal. So who has the first question for Steve?
Hello, Steven. Why do hats go on your head?
Well, because when you put them on your butt, they're called pants. Next question.
What's your favorite dinosaur?
Good question, Roman. My favorite dinosaur is Patrick. Patrick Dinosaur. Good guy. You'd like him.
So unlike Steven tonight, our job is not to share things for comic relief, but rather to share what the real life experts in the agricultural fields have to say about the real questions that students have about science. And so to prepare for tonight, we polled students from Oregon, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. So tried to get across the country here to share what their questions are. And we are thankful for their participation. And you will get to meet a couple of them. They recorded their questions for you. Not all of them, but a few of them. So this is how it's going to work. We have some questions ready for tonight, already pre-prepared. And the students have asked their questions via video or email. So we'll either play the student video or we'll read out the question. And then our expert, Janielle Taylor, who I will introduce in just a moment, will share her thoughts about how to answer the question for the students. So this one will help you figure out how to incorporate these student questions into your class and ones that you get in the classroom and in that planning and delivering content. So I am so excited to welcome Miss Janielle Taylor. She's a graduate from the University of Florida in 2012, and she spent 8 years in the classroom as an agriculture teacher, teaching both agri-science and also horticulture. And recently, she transitioned to work full-time at her family nursery in 2021. Her role at Ralph Taylor's Nurseries is the nursery manager, and she wears many hats such as plant production, propagation, irrigation technician. They had a broken line this weekend. She was just out fixing it. I got to follow along on her Instagram. Integrated pest management and all media outlets. So she is a jack of many trades. She is an FNGLA certified horticulture professional and a licensed pesticide applicator in Florida. And in her spare time, she loves to read, garden, and volunteer time at their local church and in their community. So I believe Janielle is on with us. There she is. I get to see you. Perfect. We're gonna start off with question number one, and then she's the expert. So I'm gonna hand it over to her and she's gonna answer that question. So question number one is, what pest control practices do you have set in place, and how are those practices better or worse than others?
Perfect. Well, thanks, Hannah. Can you hear me?
Am I good? Yes, we can.
Perfect. Well, first of all, congratulations to all of y'all for showing up. You know, being a teacher, you only get a limited amount of time in the summer. So I give y'all props. I was a summer guru when it came to, you know, professional development. So I love it. Go away, Juniper. Anywho, so integrated pest management, absolutely number one thing when it comes to pest control. There's a lot of old school folks that are like, I'm going to do it the old school way. Well, the old school way is no longer. We need to focus on integrated pest management. So Hannah's got up there the four-tier structure. So we've got to set our action threshold, monitor and identify pests, prevention and control. So I would definitely dissect it into those four tier structures when you're talking about teaching the kids and then go into them. Maybe you could do a roundtable discussion about each one. But setting that threshold being, how many pests am I going to allow on my plants, on my vegetables before I do something? when am I going to start losing money? Or when are the plants going to start croaking out because I've got too many insects? So that's step one. Without a doubt, you have to figure out what's your threshold. Some people are going to say, I don't care. And other people are going to be like, if I see two insects, they're going down. So it just depends on your practice. But for me, I definitely like to have a balance. And then of course, monitor and identify pests. You have to know what you're talking about, what you're looking at in order to actually take care of those pests. So we did a lot of activities when I was in the classroom of identifying pests. What's a good insect? What's a bad insect? You have to be able to identify them in order to know how to control them or not control them if they're a good insect. Prevention is absolutely important. We recently had an issue with whitefly. It's a little fly. It was on the last screen. And come to find out, I hadn't been taking care of the weeds as well as I should because we were lacking labor and whatnot. And sure enough, that's where they were living in. So my insect problem increased because my prevention wasn't there of taking down the weeds. Had we pulled the weeds, they would have nowhere to hide, not as much room to hide. And so we would have been an easier time taking care of it. And we're still trying to recover from our heat and whitefly problem. And then of course, control. Control is huge. You know, a lot of people resort straight to insecticides. So, you know, killing insects using chemicals. Our nursery really focused on letting nature and letting the good bugs take over first. So whether that's ladybugs, whether that's, you know, we have some beneficial mites that actually eat the whitefly. So I put out, golly, thousands and thousands of those in the nursery the other day. So that's a really cool process. But if not, yeah, you do have to resort to chemicals if you're talking about, you know, trying to have good yield or trying to have plants that you're putting in the store. And so we try to use chemicals at our nursery that are, you know, lower grade. We use a lot of neem oil. So it's an organic OMRI certified spray that basically suffocates the insect and it does a really good job and it doesn't hurt the environment because at the end of the day, IPM is there to protect the environment, but also take care of the problem at the same time. So is there a better or a worse? It depends who you talk to. I'm sure there are people that are better than me at doing IPM. But then of course, on the flip side, there's some old school people that two insects and I'm spraying insecticide and that's it. You know, obviously in my opinion, that's the worst way to do it. But yeah, I mean, IPM is absolutely 100% the best way in order to manage pests.
Awesome. Thank you. All right. Question number two, we get to hear from one of our students live, or well, not live, recorded a video.
What are the important invasive species in agriculture or certain aspects in agriculture?
All right. That might have been a little bit quiet for you, but he said, what are the most impactful invasive species in agriculture or in certain aspects of agriculture? So I'm going to hand it on
out. Yeah, there's a lot, to be honest. And obviously I'm going to take the horticulture pathway here. But one that you wouldn't think of is your ornamental plants. Definitely. I feel like we're like, oh, this flower looks so beautiful. Well, the average homeowner, the average Home Depot shopper, they don't know that a Mexican petunia is invasive and is actually destroying the environment and spreading everywhere and ruining native habitats. They're just like, oh, it's a pretty purple flower. Or for instance, us, we used to grow silverthorn and had no idea it was invasive. Nothing came out until one day we were just on a website and we're like, oh man, that's invasive. Guess we should stop growing it. And so unfortunately there is a lot of nurseries and a lot of landscapers still installing these plants. And as our climate changes, whether you believe in climate change or not, it's getting hotter. And so there's more opportunity for those invasive plants. And invasive plant list is always changing. And so I think that's something that we don't really acknowledge in agriculture, but it's there. And then obviously you've got your big ones. You can see the bottom picture, the Asian citrus psyllid is still huge and it's a big problem. You know, I'm in Florida and we're the citrus state, but yet our citrus production continues to decline because, you know, this insect showed up in 1998 and now it's gone from Florida to Texas, to Georgia, to Mississippi, to Alabama, Louisiana, South Carolina, California, and Arizona, it's everywhere. And unfortunately, it really focuses on your commercial varieties of citrus. And so that's a huge issue when it comes to invasive species. And then one recently that we have in Florida It's called a pepper thrip. It just appeared in the last 2 years, and now it has caused 23% loss of peppers in Florida. And peppers is a huge production in Florida, if you can believe it or not, where peppers and tomatoes are big. And so, but not only does it affect peppers, it affects hibiscus and gardenias. And so that's things that we grow. And so we've been inspected by the Florida Department of Agriculture to make sure that we do not have this invasive species and it doesn't get north of Florida. So invasive species is always changing, but definitely a fun activity. I used to do it with my kids. They'd each get an invasive species. I've done the line where I would read out plant names and they pick, is it an invasive or the native? So there's a lot of fun activities you can do with invasive species for sure.
All right. What does the future of hydroponics and vertical farming look like in your mind?
So I had a hydroponic unit in my classroom. Absolutely loved it. I thought it was great. Highly recommend it if you've never done it, especially if y'all are in the cold and you've got winters up there, which I don't really have a winter, but it's all good. but I think it's really cool. I like vertical farming. I think it's a great concept. I like hydroponics. I think it's a great concept because we have developed 70% of land already. So it's like we're not, agricultural land just isn't appearing. You know, if anything, it's going away, especially, you know, in Florida, we're losing agricultural land every day to development. So how do we turn that around? You know, we can do hydroponics, we can do vertical farming, but on the flip side, well, how much does that cost? You know, and so even the hydroponic unit in my classroom was almost $1,000 that grew like 20 plants. So that capital investment is so high for somebody to even try to get into that industry. And at the same time, you're still using the same amount of water. You're growing inside, so you'll need electricity to light your building. So is it offsetting the cost, or is it just like we talk about electric cars, and, you know, electric cars is the same issue, you know, where you're plugging it in. So you're using power unless you're using solar. So I think it's a catch-22, really. Do I think it's a great concept? Absolutely. But do we focus that time and that money into other agriculture areas where we talk about sustainability, we talk about regenerative agriculture, you know, no-till farming? Do we focus on that, or do we go the route of vertical and hydroponics? You know, it's a tough decision, but I think there's an opportunity there for sure.
Awesome. Thank you. And I noticed a couple of you are dropping questions in the chat. That is perfect because we do have some time at the end to ask those questions. So as questions come up, you can just keep putting them in the chat and I'm keeping track of them. And then we have 6 questions tonight. So when we get through those, if we still have time, we'll grab the questions at the end. So our next question is, are flowers easier to grow than plants and vegetables? Kind of a fun question from one of our students.
It is. It's definitely fun. I think other people might have differing opinions, but I think flowers are easier. When you think of a flower, you can think of it as, you know, it's got a quarter of a season for an annual. It's either spring or summer or fall or winter. And so already you're like up in your chances because you've got, you know, a quarter of time of the year in order to grow this plant, or you've got perennials that consistently grow year round. And so you probably will be more successful because you don't have as many restrictions on the season. And I found that our flowers have less pest pressure. There is pest pressure there, but for some reason, man, insects love vegetables without a doubt. You can have a beautiful squash and the next day you go out to pick it and, you know, and there's cucumber melon worms in there and it's over, you know? So at least with the plant, you know, you're like, yeah, it's all right. I'll survive a couple insects, but that squash is gone now that it has a worm in it. But vegetables, for sure, they've got a very strict season, you know, depending on where you're at, especially if you're in north, you know, winter is out for you guys. You know, for us, it's summer, man. There's certain months you can only plant one item. So bulb onions, if you miss October, it's not going to happen. If you miss pumpkins in July, not going to happen because of the weather that we have. And so pests love, insects love vegetables way more than flowers. So you have less issues there. And I think also timing, you know, you've got a better broad spectrum time when it comes to flowers versus vegetables, although vegetables are tasty.
Can I share something on the line of that? I had hydroponics in Alaska, and that was the vegetables growing only if they were something that would grow in a container. Otherwise, it was too much of an effort. And yes, we grew them inside in the school itself.
Oh, that's very cool. I love that. Okay, I think this is a recording first of a student here.
Does the moisture of the soil affect the quality of the crop planted on it in terms of yield and moisture to grain?
So I love this question because I am dealing with a lot of soil issues currently. And look at, he wants to ask this again. And so soil is absolutely huge. I mean, it's like the bread of life, I feel like. But I don't grow grain, but obviously like I can explain it. So soil, there's this point where it's good. 20 to 60% most crops like a water range. But then the issue with soil is it's so touchy because if you go north of 60%, you know, you're looking at oversaturation. Well, what happens with oversaturation? Well, the roots literally can't breathe. And so that's unfortunately what I did with my gardenias is I put them in the same section as fountain grass, and fountain grass loves water and gardenias don't. And so needless to say, I had a lot of oversaturation. And so my roots died off and now I'm dealing with yellow gardenias and it's a whole mess, but it's a learning experience. I'm still not an expert and I don't know that I ever will be fully. But absolutely, there is that oversaturation point where it's too wet, it can't breathe, it needs oxygen. But then on the flip side, you know, you've got unavailable water. So the temperature is too hot and there's not enough available water. So the plant's at that permanent wilting point where it's like, I can't come back from this. And so finding that balance, that field capacity of that water, how much can the water hold versus how much can the water drain? And obviously, when it comes to soils, you know, is it sandy soil? Is it silty soil? Is it loamy soil? Is it clay? And so those things affect it. Sand has larger pore spaces, so water's going to move through it more quickly. So your plants are more likely to have that permanent wilting point issue versus, you know, oversaturation. But flip side, if you have more clay in your soil, you know, you're going to deal with more oversaturation because the water has nowhere to go because of those small pore sizes. So an example for my husband, man, he loves to water. He loves to water our vegetables so much, like every day. And I'm like, no, like they're good. They're good. And sure enough, he had probably 30 cherry tomatoes and every single one of them split because it was too much water. And so it had nowhere to go. And I mean, ornamental plants do that too. You'll see the leaf will get this little ring and this little brown spot. And it's because the cells have exploded because there's just too much water. It just has nowhere to send that water. And so unfortunately, overwatering is usually the reason why plants die. It's not permanent wilting point.
I'm learning stuff tonight. So this is so great. Like, is that why the cherry tomatoes split? All right. What kind of jobs are available in the greenhouse and landscaping industry?
I love this question because I think there are so many opportunities and so many jobs that people don't, and kids especially, they don't recognize. They're just like, well, they grow plants. And that's their answer. Well, there's so much more to just growing plants. So obviously there's nursery growers, you know, they could be a retail garden center where, you know, grandma and grandpa come and buy their little plants. They could be wholesale to where it's just to landscapers and that's it. Or our nursery is contract growers. So we grow for Home Depot. We grow for 44 different stores. Then of course there's landscaping, but there's so much that goes into landscaping. So the landscaping technicians that take care of the plants, they've got the contractors who do the work and the installs, the architects who design it, the interior scape. So if you've got a fancy hotel or a restaurant and you want a living wall, you know, there are people that do that job. We've got one here and it's a $3 million company and they take care of plants and hotels. Yeah. I used to work for them. So that's why I know that. There's arborists and in Florida, there's only, I think it's 620 certified arborists and that's it. So it's a small field, but they make really good money. Other jobs can be irrigation installation, irrigation technicians. You know, think about how many residential homes there are. And here, everybody has irrigation systems. So, you know, granny doesn't know how to take care of them. So, you know, go on down and fix it. Entomologists, if I wasn't going to be an ag teacher, I was going to be an entomologist because I love insects. I think they're so great. But they can identify the pests. They can help create an IPM plan along with a certified insect scout who can also go in there. Our nursery before me and the guy before me, our nursery did. They hired a lady. She came out twice a week. She walked the fields. She told them how many insects they have. She made a plan. And then that was it. And they executed the plan. And then, of course, you could also look at allied fields. So chemical sales and container sales and fertilizer sales and soil sales. I mean, there's so much more than just growing plants. And I think that's what kids think about is just they just grow plants.
Yeah, I think that when we think about jobs, that is hard for students to understand what are all the jobs within the specific industry. So this is really helpful to have this listed out tonight. So we have, I would say, about 5 minutes to open up the floor for questions. I do want to go back to Carolina's question. Just understanding what is the difference between invasive versus native? So if you can answer that one, Danielle. That
I was just hoping she would share the activity because as horticulture superintendent, we created a natives class for horticulture and 4-H. And I'd love to use your activity in our next step up class.
That's so
if you're
fun.
Willing to share it.
I would have to dig up the file, but what I have done when it comes to native versus non-native is doing that line, you know, where the kids line up and hopefully they know some plants or they've heard of some plants and saying, all right, so is it Mexican petunia? Is it native or is it invasive? And same thing, you know, with animals and plants. And so that was how we kind of introduced to see where their knowledge is, because there are some kids that are just going to know it somehow, either mom or dad has talked about it, but definitely, assign them different plants and bring them into that discussion group later on and doing it that way.
All right.
Yeah.
Are there any other questions for Danielle? Put it in the chat, or you can feel free to unmute and ask if that's comfortable for you.
I see Sarah talked about good bugs eating bad bugs. Yeah, man, there's so many beneficials. It's absolutely wild. And you know, and you can buy them. So when I bought the mites, they came in these little packets, like about this big, on a stick. And so every plant got one. And sure enough, they just ate all the white flies. They basically go in and eat the nymphs, and they eat the larva, and then they eat the adults. And it's a wild industry to be in. My neighbor actually sells a bunch of insects that are biological control. Lacewing is another really great insect that you can buy it in the eggs, you can buy it in the larval stage, you can buy it as an adult. And they just come in the mail, and I got to make sure that I'm there, because if I'm not and they sit in the box overnight, you know, you're looking at a couple $100 down the drain because you didn't let your insects out.
Okay, curiosity here. Are these just like open like to the public to buy, or is this something that like can you buy beneficial insects at like because you have a license? Like, how does that work?
I know that like you can buy a bunch on Amazon, surprisingly. You can buy ladybugs on Amazon. But I'm pretty sure most, you know, biological, like we use Certus Biological for a lot, and they just sell it to anybody, you know?
Yeah. Let's just be aware, unless you're in a high tunnel or a greenhouse, chances are they'll fly away. So you're better off creating an environment for the beneficials first, like leaving a tall area for them to live in and stay, and they will be there first thing in spring instead of buying them. So it's better to create a good habitat for the beneficial insects in your area than purchasing them.
Yeah, Debbie, we can add that to our list of our list of jobs, being able to supply beneficial bugs. Okay. All right. Well, we are going to wrap up then tonight. We do have one more question. And I would love, Amy, for you to be able to have a chance to answer this really quickly. So how do you control grasshoppers, and or if that's a thing that you need to control in your industry?
For for ornamental plants, I don't have an issue. I don't have an issue with grasshoppers whatsoever. They just roll out. If we do see the big lubber grasshoppers, we take the foot stomping and baseball bats because they really like crinum lilies. And so we've got some in our backyard. And so sure enough, that's what we do is we go stomp them.
Okay, awesome. All right, we're going to wrap up. If we can just give Janielle like a virtual round of applause and just thank her for being here tonight. As a professional in that field, I have been following along and this woman works at 16-hour days. It seems like she's always in the field doing something. And so I just appreciate her taking some time out of her busy day and her schedule to be here with us tonight. So I am going to send it on over to Sarah.
Awesome. Thank you, Janielle. It's always awesome to learn from you. And I want science teachers who are in the room, this conversation, I hope it was stirring up like, oh, that would be a cool problem to investigate. That would be a cool phenomena. And if you were at our last, I think it was our last webinar, and if you weren't, there is recordings available. We talked about how to start making a lesson with a student question. So we just went through six different student questions and your students ask a ton of questions. And I bet you have a ton of questions just from that short conversation with Janielle, that the productive thing now is to take that and help harness that curiosity to use into your classroom, to create a lesson, to create something that is revolving around NGSS for those kids to dive into sense making. This is just so invigorating and really an inspiration for you all to find industry professionals in your area, like Janielle, maybe in different agriculture industries, to have a conversation, to have your kids have a conversation so you can get this content, get these ideas out of the brains of your students, out of the brains of you and the industry professionals to create really cool, relevant science learning for your kids, because we know that relevancy is super, super important. The replay, Hannah, I think on the takeaway document, I've linked the website. So the website where you can watch the previous sessions should be on the takeaway document. All right, as we are getting into the chat, I really want to hear what was your biggest learning moment tonight? So you heard about productive talk, you practiced the five whys, and then you got to hear all about the industry, the horticulture industry. What was kind of your big takeaway? You can drop that into the chat. Kelly liked the productive talk. Absolutely. What we just had was great productive talk with Janielle. Love the comparison of phenomena questions and specific to agriculture, how they're relatable. The five whys, lesson using questions, five whys. Talking to other educators from states where my who also have the passion for agriculture education. Yes, this is a passionate group. Five Y strategy, really getting kids thinking. Thank you for sharing. So before you leave, Hannah's going to drop one more time the survey in the chat. The survey is also linked on your takeaway document as the last part of the table. This is going to help us prepare for our next webinar, which, speaking of, will be very similar to this webinar. It's part two of Students Asked, We Answered. We're going to go through one more teaching practice to get kids talking, and we are going to have an amazing guest speaker with us who has done some professional development with us, and I was glued to the screen watching a recording of her and cannot wait for you guys to meet her next webinar, which is on Thursday, July 27th, starting at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And we cannot wait to see you there. Make sure you fill out the survey before you leave, and we'll see you guys in 2 weeks. Thanks for being here.